field test of the Zig Brushables water-based markers. So before we get into coloring the piece, I wanted to go over a couple of things. As you can see here, I have several markers laid out. These are all Zig products. They're all made by the company Kuretake, and they're all water-based markers. These are the Zig Art and Graphic Twin. As you can see, they're twin-tipped. One end is a bullet nib, the other end is a very flexible brush nib. It's kind of my favorite brush nib for these kind of water-based graphic illustration markers. And I've tested these as watercolor markers in the past. If you're interested in that, you should check out my blog. Next are the brushables, which we're going to be going over today. They are also twin-tipped, but like I said earlier, one end has one of the memory system colors, the other one has a tint of that same color, much lighter though. The brush is not nearly as nice or as flexible as the one on the Art and Graphic Twin. And then the other Zig family colors, Zig memory system brush I own, is the Zig Clean Color Real Brush. And it has actual bristles, so it is extremely flexible. And there isn't yet a post at the time of me recording this. This isn't up on my blog yet, but I have a video for it, and I'm working on the post. I've already done the field test. So as you can see, they're very different, although they're in the same memory system family. And I believe the brushables have the smallest color family out of all of them. There's 24 total colors. The Art and Graphic Twin and the Zig Clean Color Real Brush have larger color larger color families available. So while you can't find the Zig brushables on Dick Blick, which is kind of my go-to for art supplies, you can find them on Amazon. Just check out the annotation. And you can also get them, I think I got mine through Marker Pop, but it may have also, I may have gotten them from Dependable Art Supply as well. And I also bought some of mine in-store from my local Plaza Art Supplies. So if you're looking for these markers, if you like what you see, those are all places you should check out. So, I'm going to do some preliminary tests. I've already done the swatch test where I swatched both ends of each marker. Now I'm going to do a blendability test and a watercolor, like a water solubility test. And to help me with that, I have my handy dandy trusty Tombow ABT, which I use for a lot of my water-based marker reviews. And I have a fresh, clean, hopefully working water brush. Earlier today I had some technical issues with my old one, so I switched it out. And I'm going to go ahead and grab an alcohol marker, because sometimes the colorless blender has an effect on your water-based markers. So we're going to start with pure red, and I'm going to swatch each side and test them out with my water brush. Now, these are not intended to be watercolor markers, but I like when my water-based markers serve multiple purposes. And it would be nice if I could use them with my Art and Graphic Twins and my clean colors. So already you can see they are at least a little bit water-soluble. Although there is still, even though I'm trying to apply water as soon as I can get it on paper, there is still a line from where my brush went down to where I started scrubbing with the water. So they're not completely water soluble, or at least not all colors are. It seems like platinum is doing a pretty good job. And this is Splash. And I've mentioned in the past that I'm really not a fan of these sort of nondescript color names. As an artist, I don't find them particularly helpful. I I prefer color family names. And I'm swatching this on watercolor paper, which is why it can stand up very well to the application of water. So now I'm swatching Fawn, which has a couple of nice skin tones in it. And like I said, some of these take to water a little bit better than others. This is Root Beer Float. Actually, I was just complaining about hating color names, but I think Root Beer Float's a pretty cute color name. It definitely does remind me of a Root Beer Float. And I think other than Pure Red, most of these are inspired by both colors rather than just one side. Pure Red is more of a red and a salmon. So Root Beer Float does not take to water all that well, but so far all of our colors are staying fairly true despite adding water to them. So this one is English Lavender, and they also have a Lunar Lavender, which I'll be swatching next. And that's another reason why I'm not really a big fan of poetic names over descriptive names, because sometimes you'll end up with like six different lavenders in your collection. And speaking of lavender, the field test illustration, or one of, I think I'm going to do several to try and test out as many properties as I possibly can for these markers. The first field test illustration I'm doing, the one I'm doing with you guys tonight, is of Kara in some lavender, because I have so many lavenders, I thought that would work really well. And this is Baby Pink. So it seems like the lighter colors take to water really well. So that could be good, because those are the ones I usually want to blend with water anyway. So next I'm going to test blendability with the Tombow ABT, and I'm going to use the brush end. And I actually highly recommend this if you like using water-based markers. I've found that it works really well with Crayolas on watercolor paper. With Target's Up and Up markers, this thing is fantastic. So even if you don't own any Tombow ABTs, you should consider getting their colorless blender, because it's really versatile. So let's do a really strong color. Let's do Pure Red, the one I was just complaining about. All right, so it actually really takes well to the Tombow ABT. And I do have a little bit of schmutz on my blender pen, so I'm gonna get rid of it. So yeah, it blends almost better with the Tombow ABT than it does with the water. So that's something to consider. And now I'm going to try blending. Let's go Pure Red from this to Baby Pink. Right? So that should be a pretty good indication. Ooh, so far it blends pretty well on its own. Maybe instead of brushables, it should have been called blendables. I am working fairly deep into the original color, just to kind of pick some up on my nib, work it out. So there was a little bit of a transition from Pure Red to Baby Pink right here, but it's really not a bad one. And there are some other reds available. I only have two of their four available red markers, which would give you eight total red tones, which isn't bad. Just because there's only 24 markers available, you really have 48 colors, which is a pretty good range. And these handle really pretty well. I'm pretty impressed. I guess I could have also gone Lunar Lavender to English Lavender. Do you guys want to do that? Yeah, let's do that. One successful test is not a definitive answer make. So my recommendation when you're working with water-based markers, if you need to blend a color out, is I recommend going into the darker color with the lighter color so you can pick up some of that pigment. Now, as you can see, English, the transition from lunar lavender to English lavender. Lunar lavender is a more gray lavender. English lavender is a more purple lavender. I really could have skipped the more saturated color and gone straight into the tint. So it would have been a three-way blend because the transition is a little bit harsh, but I only have two of the four purples. I think they have four purples. I'd have to double check on that one. Yeah, it looks like four purples. I only have two of the four purples, unless they're considering one of the blues, but I think it's just purples. I only have two of the available four purples. Yeah. So there may be better blends available, and I may just not have the right colors. And going back to the pure red and baby pink, it's when it dries, it's a slightly better transition. And it's hard for you guys to see, so I'm going to have to take pictures of all this to post to the blog later. So that's the swatch test. Now we're going to do the first field test. And I'm thinking there's going to be at least two field tests, probably three. One on the Winsor and Newton pigment paper, because when I inked this, I thought it would handle these markers really well, and now I'm starting to have my doubts. Another one on probably a cold press wood pulp based watercolor paper, sort of like this right here, because the wood pulp based papers tend to take scrubbing from water based markers a little bit better than cotton based watercolor papers, and I want to do a direct application. And I might do a watercolor test, but considering they're part of the Zig memory system, and I've already tested the graphic twin, and I've already tested the clean color, I'm pretty sure they work well as watercolors, or decently well as watercolors. So I don't really want to focus on that. So I will be right back. You know what I forgot? I forgot to test the alcohol base marker. So let me do that really quick. And there is no guarantee, and it does not count against these markers if they don't blend out with the alcohol base marker. It was just curiosity on my part because I know that sometimes alcohol markers can affect. And no, not really. Okay, so you can probably use these in addition to your alcohol base marker collection. My recommendation, however, is you apply your alcohol base markers first and then you use your water base markers. Because even though it doesn't really blend, let me zoom in or try to. It does smear a little and it kind of grays the brown out. It's not nearly as nice as using the water or using the Tombow ABT blender. So alcohol markers are not really the blender you want to use with these. All right, so I've got my line art erased, and if you're interested in what I think of Winsor & Newton's new pigment marker paper, you should check out the video where I talk about that and the pigment markers. And while I was cleaning this up, I realized I don't actually have any greens in the brush. I didn't buy any greens in the Brushables. I thought I had a green marker. Like, I remember Art Snacks sending me one years ago, and I can't find it right now. So what I've decided to do, if it's okay with you guys, is pull from the Zig memory system and grab, I think I have a couple greens. Yeah, I literally have a couple greens when it comes to the Art and Graphic Twin. I think I have some more for the clean color, but I think that should be enough. I just want to give the impression of being in the grass, which should be fun for me because, because of reasons, cryptic reasons. So I think what I'm going to do is maybe color in the lavender first and then work around it. We'll see. I'm sorry, I'm giving extremely cryptic answers right now. And what you didn't see me do, that I totally just did, was I went and I pulled up some reference images of lavender. And something I'm already noticing about the marker paper is that these water-based markers are not activating my Sailor Mitsuo Aida ink, so I'm not necessarily getting the same smudging I was getting with the pigment markers. So I may have found a marker that I like using on this paper. I like the paper. I don't like the ghosting. I don't like how hard it is to erase on this paper. But, I think I just have to find the good points, you know, or try to, at least. Oh, there we go. Now it's smudging. See right there? Oh, no, you can't. Let me zoom in. And this is dried at least, this has actually dried for longer than 24 hours. See, it's smudging already. What is it with this paper and Mitsuo Aida ink? Mitsuo Aida works on like everything else. That's crazy. Just means I have to be really careful. And this is a water thing, so it shouldn't even be such a problem. That is both interesting and really disheartening. No, but I had hoped that the slick surface of this paper would mean that I could easily blend the brushables. I'm gonna have to remind myself not to treat them like alcohol markers, because they are not. Oh, I'm sorry. I'll pull out for you guys. Sorry about that. In the past few weeks, my recording setup has changed so much for the better. So I got a gooseneck mount, which means that I can work at my table. And I'd never really used my drafting table until I'd started recording regularly. And I will be painting 7-inch Kara pages soon, so I'm probably going to be back on the floor for a while. But it is nice to have a desk that I feel comfortable at and I'm excited to use again. And then I had to improve the lighting, so that took a while. That was kind of a struggle. And we even installed some LED lights onto the ceiling. And there's a video of us doing that and getting cranky at each other about it. That's going to get uploaded, maybe, because the LED lights actually don't provide any sort of useful lighting. So I think I'm going with LED strip lights. I got a side table, like a plastic card table, plastic table to put on the side of my drafting table. And that's where I can put my laptop and my markers live there. And like stuff that I need, stuff that needs to be handy but takes up desk space can live there. And it means my desk can be clear. And that is like the biggest accomplishment of this year. I'm so excited about that. That's been great. I need to keep it clean though. Like, it's right now, it's kind of just, I need to organize it again. So I'm the sort of person, once things start becoming disorganized, like they very quickly stay that way forever and I never use them. And this is something that's actually improved my, there it goes again, smearing. And I'm being careful. Which is a shame because I like to put like shading in those areas where the ink kind of meets up. And that means I have to really dance around it, which I don't like. So, as I said in the Winsor Newton pigment marker, Winsor Newton pigment paper video, if you know of an ink that works on this paper, please let me know. And I would love to give it a try. I'm only using the Mitsuo Aida because I usually use it for all of my tests because it works for both alcohol-based markers and water-based markers. I use it for watercolor stuff too sometimes. You know, it's a workhorse kind of a inking tool. Plus, it's a brush pen and I like inking with a brush. I hate inking with tech pens, but I love inking with brush pens because they're so portable, they're so easy, they're so low maintenance. So this is the first time I've encountered, well, this and Yupo are the first time I've encountered papers that it just doesn't work on. And it used to be, with other papers, when I had that problem, it meant I hadn't let the ink cure long enough. But I don't know, I've usually 24 hours is plenty good enough. Some people don't even let their ink cure an hour before they're erasing it. But I try to let it cure at least an hour, ideally 24. So the fact that I can't use my favorite pen on this paper is really frustrating for me. It's because I'm a baby. A giant, spoiled baby. And see, the fact that everything I've tested so far reactivates the Mitsuo Aida on this paper makes it hard for me to comment on these pens. I mean, their nib is not as flexible as a Copic Superbrush, but it's pretty flexible. It's also not as flexible as the Art and Graphic Twin, which I demonstrated for you guys a few minutes ago. But it's really not bad. It's better than a lot of brands. And it makes coloring like this or rendering so much faster. You can just zip through. I think I'm going to use a paper towel to kind of be a hand rest on this. But I also don't know how these layer yet, you know? I'm still just coloring in lavender. And I don't actually think these are necessarily meant to be used as like an illustration marker. They're probably, and I'm going to test these when I go to visit my mom in Louisiana, they are probably great in adult coloring books for adults, especially if it has like a thicker paper or if it's printed on one side. But I'm going to have to do pilling tests. Ugh. So frustrating. And I'm making sure to clean the Mitsuo Aida ink out of my nib, out of my brush, so it doesn't ruin the... And see, I was a dummy. This paper doesn't layer very well. I didn't know that when I inked this. All I was thinking was, this handles ink so well, because I had done a Copic marker piece on this paper, and the inks for that turned out really well. I was really pleased with them. So I was like, this is great paper to ink on. It's so smooth. It really takes the ink well. And now I'm like, oh, I wish I hadn't. I hate this. I'm even, because I can't find, or because I haven't found an ink that works on this paper and doesn't ghost when it erases and it doesn't, smear when you add any sort of marker on top of it, and I'm gonna have to do more testing. I'm even going to do something I normally never do, and pull out my lightbox and try to use the pigment markers. Oh, that's gonna be a disaster because they're opaque. I'm gonna use the pigment markers over on this paper, on top of a line art in my sketchbook, and then digitally compose the two to see if that works any better. I'm just so frustrated by how my ink's been behaving. And I don't know if it's the fault of the Mitsuo Aida ink. I don't know if it's the fault of the paper. You know, there's so many variables. There, she's wearing a little lavender hat. Oh, how cute. So that is the tint of English lavender. Now we're going to start moving into the actual color. And then on top of this, I think I'm going to use lunar lavender. I wish I'd drawn all the lavenders as open cones like this, because this is not causing the problems that those closed cones are going to cause. Let's try some blending. Oh, look at that. It blends. Aw, yeah. see, I figured the surface of this paper would be good for blending. The problem is it's going to reactivate that ink, and that ink is going to look gross and make everything look dirty and smeary and sad. So the trick is going to be finding a paper that, or an ink, finding a paper and ink combination that works well with these markers. Because these markers seem pretty, seem pretty alright, except for where it reactivates. And I just have a piece of clean cardstock taped over to the side so I can clean my marker, because this has been an issue for today. The whole, it's really reactivating the ink now. It looks so gray because of it too. That's so frustrating. It's not any reflection on these markers, by the way. These markers so far are fine. That's a shame. Look, you can even see some of the smear. But yeah, that the going back and forth is pretty cool. So I've reviewed chameleon markers in the past, and they're these alcohol-based markers that basically have the blender in the cap. And I'm not a fan of them. But what I would like to see is an alcohol-based marker following this concept, where you have the darker color on one end and the lighter color on the other. Because it makes it so much easier to blend when you're just like flipping it over. I thought the chameleon markers were kind of poorly executed personally. I am, however, having trouble on this paper, so this is not a reflection of the markers still. Now it's layering okay, and I will bet you any money that if I added another layer of the tint color rather than the actual color, it would just pick it all up. And you know, water-based markers just don't blend the same way that alcohol-based markers blend, so you need to keep that in mind with your illustrations and just kind of account for that. You probably can't go back and forth as much, and it's a shame, but I probably shouldn't mess around with the Tombow blender on this paper, because if I'm having problems with it smearing right now, it's going to be a bigger problem with the Tombow ABT. But I mean, neither of this, I was just hoping the two would work together well. I was hoping the smooth surface of this marker paper would be beneficial to blending these markers, and it is with open line works. But keep in mind when judging these markers that this paper is not the use case scenario. This is not what these markers were designed for. This paper wasn't designed for these markers, so don't judge either by this test. I'm sorry I picked a paper that, the open lavenders look so much nicer than the closed in lavender, and it's really because of the smearing. The smearing really makes a negative difference. So that's a shame. And I'm even trying to like brush into it, not scrub from it. Just really trying to baby it and compensate for the problems I know it has. I'm sorry, I'll try not to complain the whole time. I have a feeling, though, I will be upset about my ink the whole time. Which is a shame, because this illustration, while kind of simple and kind of similar to another one I've recently done, which is much better, but it's in watercolor and it's a big piece, I just thought it was, like, a cute little take on the idea I'm exploring or playing around with, whatever. And I also thought if it turned out nice, I might offer it as, like, because I'm working on getting a Patreon together. And I want to be able to offer original art, both, like, commission-style slots and field tests. And I probably shouldn't let my field tests go, because I do reference them on in post and on camera. But, you know, I would rather somebody own it than it never get used. But other than the ink, this paper works pretty well with these particular markers. See if I can't fix this right there. Yeah, a little bit. I'm gonna have a lot of lavender to do. And I still need to do the line art for my second field test for this, which is gonna be on watercolor paper, like dry on watercolor paper. And if you guys are really, really want to see these as used as watercolors, although I'm telling you, they probably work pretty well, I can do a third test on that at a later time. And if you have any questions about Zig Brushables that I can answer, you should leave me a comment or send me an email, and I'll try to either write you a response. I'll either write you a response or do a video about the question, depending on what it is, depending on how in-depth it is. And if there's a tutorial you would like, let me know that as well. I'm currently working on a ginormous comic craft tutorial as I'm working on chapter 6. And I have a mostly written but desperately needs editing post all about self-publishing and self-promoting your self-published work. Like, that's been going on for a year, and I just, you know, I don't know, I don't ever make time to finish it for personal reasons. Maybe I will this Christmas. Probably not. I always, anytime I go back to Luling, I'm like, I'm going to finish all these things, and then I don't do any of them, and that's okay. But, like, I really need to quit telling myself I'm going to do these things that I'm not going to do. And just take the time off. So I thought, I signed up for Sketchbox, there we go. Which is a subscription art supply service, because I've done art snacks in the past, and that's actually what my mom is giving me for Christmas, is another art snacks subscription, so I can continue reviewing them. Well, so I can offer the reviews as a Patreon tier, is the true answer. That's what I wanted. And I subscribe myself to like 6 months of Sketchbox. And I did it November 22nd, and the website says if you do it after the 20th, you won't get this month's box, you'll get next month's box. So I thought that meant I wasn't going to get the November box, I'd get the December box. Well, no, it's like almost mid-December, no box. So, and no emails either, no kind of confirmation, no information, nothing. So I sent them an email. Apparently I'm going to get the January box. And I'm a little bit disappointed because I'd wanted to do an unboxing, but that's okay because it's pigment markers and chameleon markers, and I already have a bunch of pigment markers, and I've already reviewed chameleon markers, and I don't care for them all that much, so I'm okay with skipping, with this month being skipped, I should say. I guess that gives me something to look forward to in January. This is a pretty elaborate field test. Usually my field tests are very, very, very simple because I don't want to spend 4 hours on a field test. I think I'd had high hopes for these turning out, this turning out well. Well, I mean, it's not bad. I'm just like really cross about the gray, right? And I know that's going to come into the skin tone, and that really is already making me annoyed. And that's my fault. That's my poor choices. Not anybody else's. Because, like, by the time... I mean, I'd already inked this. But by the time I'd gotten to this today, I was like, I already know this paper is not going to take. I was just hoping that because it wasn't alcohol-based. I was hoping the Mitsuo Aida would fare a little bit better. But like I said, if you guys have any suggestions, I have tried in the past, not on this particular paper, Kaimei Sol K, which is a bottled ink that you use with brushes or nibs. That's Copic proof, but not waterproof. India ink is not Copic proof, but it is waterproof. I've used Microns and Multiliners, and both of them are Copic and waterproof, but they're tech pens, and I really don't like inking with tech pens anymore. It like kills my hand. It takes forever. I know they make brushes too. I just don't care for their brushes. They're like kind of loose, which is great if for gestural kind of sketches, but they're too loose for the kind of drawings I like to do. I'm really looking for a good brush pen that is waterproof and Copic proof and works on this kind of paper. Oh yeah, so for the UPO test, I'd also tested I had tested all kinds of stuff, like tech pens from Japan that were oil-based and tech pens from Japan that were meant to be used on photographs and were meant to mark plastic, and like I really tried like everything. And some of them could stand up to water being added, and some of them, none of them could stand alcohol marker repeated application. All of them smeared with just the slightest bit of provocation. So there's also that, and I need to write a post about that at some point. In case other people are awake at night caring way too much about art supplies the way I seem to be. I have some UPO transparent because I want to mess around with the pigment markers and maybe these, all kinds of stuff really, on the transparent paper. I still have some UPO white, but I don't care for it very much. Pretty much the only thing that I know is indelible, not counting alcohol markers, is graphite. And also, if your hand, like if your hand leaves oils on the page, it'll form like a resist, so the watercolors won't go down properly. And I have like actual examples of my own work where that happened on UPO. But I found out recently, if you wipe it down with rubbing alcohol, which won't work if you are doing alcohol-based marker stuff, but if you rub it down with rubbing alcohol, that'll remove the oils from your hands on the paper and will allow you to work it again without it leaving a resist. So if any of you guys use UPO, and that's a problem, or has been a problem for you, now you know. I found that out reading Amazon reviews. And I mean, people also do like these alcohol-based paintings. Alcohol-based ink paintings, which I actually did a million years ago. I did like kind of a tutorial for Copic about that, but I didn't, but there were problems. I was the problem. It didn't turn out the way I wanted it to, so I'm not gonna say I don't know how to paint with alcohol inks on Yupo, but I would like to learn how to paint with alcohol inks on Yupo. Gosh, this lavender is taking forever. So my apologies on that. And if you haven't yet, and you're so inclined, I would really appreciate it if you left a comment, because I would really like to know what you guys think and what I can do to better suit your interests. So please drop me a line and let me know. You can ask me questions. You can make tutorial suggestions. I would love it if you made tutorial suggestions, because I really want to do tutorials for you guys. And I don't want to do the same stuff everybody else does, because, you know, they've done it. But if there's something I do a particular way that you're interested in, or a material you see me use, and I never talk about it, please leave me a comment. And let me know you're interested. And particularly astute subscribers might notice I recently added ads to specific videos on this channel. Right now it's really just on like marker reviews and a couple of tutorials. And the reason I did that is just to help offset the cost of supplies that I buy out of pocket, because for the most part, I buy everything myself. And one of the Patreon goals, one of the Patreon rewards, is going to be to get rid of ads, because I don't care for ads, but I would really appreciate it if you enjoy my content. You just like sit through the 30 minutes of that ad so I can get the money for at least 30 minutes. You might like that. There's sometimes I think there's some really cute ones, especially from other YouTubers. Those I'll tend to sit through the whole thing. And I watch YouTube while I work. But I would really appreciate it if you didn't just skip them and you turned off your ad blocker when you're reading my blog, because that kind of revenue helps people like me do stuff for you guys pretty much for free. Your cost of admission is sitting through 30 seconds of an ad. And that's really not too bad. And there's some YouTubers who will say things like, well, if you weren't going to watch it otherwise, then you can skip it. And I'm saying, if you like watching art supply reviews and tutorials, you will watch the ad for me, because it helps me buy those things. And I mean, if you're just like so morally opposed to ads, you can totally skip the ads if you buy stuff out of my shop. Wow, am I allowed to even say that? I have no idea. We'll find out. But if you do show some form of support, you can skip the ad. You have my permission. You have my blessing. But I mean, let's face it, the kind of people who hear me say, please don't skip the ads until I'm a little more solvent because that helps me buy the things I review. And it helps fund tutorials and stuff. The ones who do that and then skip the ad anyway, they're not going to be the sort of people probably to go buy something from the shop or to, like, send $5 over PayPal. So, that's a shame. That's, like, every stage of life, you know? The kids who do their homework are always the kids who think the teacher is fussing at them about doing their homework, when really she's just generally fussing at the class in general about doing their homework. That's what I'm doing. I'm fussing in general. However, that said, for videos where it's like a care of kind of video, where parts of that, of what I'm using were donated, I'm not going to put ads on that. These handle really well on this marker paper. Speaking of, like, my gripe is the Mitsuo Aida, which I normally never ever gripe about. I normally love it. So, gotta find something that's gonna work on it, because I like this paper with these markers. They handle like alcohol markers pretty much, and they're much cheaper. Although they are not refillable and you can't replace the nibs, but they're also less toxic, and you get two colors in one. But you don't get a colorless blender. But do you even need one? Probably don't really need one. Alright, so the basic lavender is finished now. I'm going to do the grass part of it. Gee, do I want to do the grass part of it now? Like the background grass? Or do I want to do the grass part of it? I should have done the sky already, and I didn't, because I already colored in those. And that would surely be a test of streaking. Let's do the skin, I guess. And be really careful with the skin, which is such a shame, because these markers are not bad. Wow. And on this paper, the markers are not streaky yet. I haven't noticed streakiness is an issue yet. I know for a fact the pigment markers were crazy streaky on this paper, to the point where it looked, my illustration, the thing I did, my test on this, looked really bad, like just terrible. And Cole Arts was kind enough to send me their regular marker paper too. So I am excited to try these and my alcohol markers and my pigment markers on their regular marker paper and see how it compares to their pigment marker paper. And I've unboxed it. I haven't even unwrapped it yet, because it's like I need to get photos and everything, because I'm going to do a post about it. Because I have all this. I was going to do a marker paper showdown anyway. I just wanted to get through my cheap art supply review series. Walmart just finished running. Target has started. And I busted my fingers, so I haven't been able to type. So I have posts until the end of December, which is weird for me at this point, because I usually have posts written up until like at the start of a new month. I have posts written up until the end of the next month. The tests for a lot of the Target stuff is done though. I just need to like be able to type everything out. But there are still a couple tests that I haven't been doing, because I'm a terrible person. Well, I bought it, so it doesn't matter. I haven't done the sketchbook test, which actually requires a lot of work. Because those of you who have seen the Walmart test, oh, it looks really cute. I'm liking it so far. Those of you who have been keeping up with the Walmart series, you know I bought a YouCreate sketchbook, and I used several different types of media in it. I used Copic markers, I did inks, I just drew in it, I did water-based, like, a couple of different water-based markers, you know, stuff you would do in a sketchbook. And I haven't been normal sketching, normal in quotes. Okay, so already I'm getting kind of a resist with the skin color, and I think it's because bits of, like, sometimes with coated papers like this, your eraser will adhere to the coating, and it can cause a bit of a resist. And it's not too bad, I just have to be careful. And so far, I've been careful enough that there isn't significant noticeable smudging of the black ink, so I'm really happy about that right now. Anyway, I need to do all those kind of tests in the Target sketchbook I bought, and I need to test the pencils and the pens, and I haven't done anything for the, other than record a video, which is in my queue, but I'm not going to load it until it's time. I haven't done anything for the Dollar Tree series other than buy everything and write the introduction post. Sorry. And I really didn't want the series to go on until March, but that is kind of where it's going. And so I've been trying to interspace other kinds of content in there. Like, okay, so far so good. I'm letting this ink dry. It probably won't layer with that color, but fortunately I have another color to do some shadows. And I also like to do skin I need to do the pink on her lips soon, and skin shadows with English lavender. Sorry. Now I lost track of what I was saying. Oh, I do have some Copic tutorials that are coming up soon, like end of December soon, post-Christmas soon. And I have like a half-written watercolor supply gift guide. But, you know, I busted my finger, so we'll see if I get that finished in any sort of a timely for Christmas fashion. And I currently, well, not currently, it went up like last week, but I have a alcohol-based marker gift guide that I'm actually really proud of. It took a lot of writing, and I did a lot of research for it. And it kind of ties in, if you go check out, last night I was adding annotations and cards to the three cheap Copic alternatives video I did, and that's to link to stuff in that post. So, you know, if you're into that, you should check that post out. If you're into water-based markers, maybe you should check Brushables out, because I'm really liking them right now. Oh, Kuretake. Why is it the things that are genuinely really good that you make so underappreciated, but everybody loves those clean color brushes, which are fine, but like these are just so much better in my opinion? I mean, they even on this paper, which, I'm not insulting this paper, it just wouldn't even let me layer. Let me grab it. Oh, come here. Oh, you're gonna be at the bottom. All right. It wouldn't even let me layer Copic markers very well. And the markers it's designed for don't layer very well on it either, necessarily, right? But water-based markers, it's like, okay, yeah, sure. And I have not had too much positive experience with marker paper and water-based markers. So, you know, like this is, I have high hopes. Maybe I'm a fool. But it makes me want to test it on other marker papers too, but, you know, I don't want to spend the rest of my life, I don't want to spend the rest of my life learning, teaching you guys about brushables. Necessarily. Alright, let's see if we can get the tint of fawn to layer. And it's okay if not, because I'm not really it's alright, okay. Alright, it layers a little bit. It is definitely a darker, slightly darker color. So that's cool. Not the marker, the paper. Makes me really excited to try these out on watercolor paper. I hope my head's not getting into the shot. I bet it is. I know that's a problem with my videos because I have poor eyesight and I don't like wearing my glasses, especially when I'm on top of it like this. But I'm stubborn, so I'll like climb onto the paper so I can see what I'm doing, and then you guys have to look at the top of my head and can't see the paper. But I've been really working on not doing that and find the worst place. The worst place you can get a smear is under the nose of a baby or a little girl in terms of markering, because it looks like a mustache, and that's just like the worst place. Or a pretty young woman, worst place for a smear. So you gotta be really careful. I mean, you can't even hide it. Once there's a smear there, doesn't matter what you do, everyone's gonna know. But I like these brushables. They're a little bit harder to find though, because I'd never seen them sold open. I hadn't seen them around a whole lot other than that Art Snacks box where I got one. Can't do much with one marker. even a dual tip marker, which is cool like this, I couldn't do much with it. And then I saw them open stock in my local plaza for the first time. Like, I went on Black Friday, because they had a 30% off deal on top of other sales. And that's when I saw them open stock, and I was like, oh yeah! But I'd already ordered some online, and then I had some repeats, and I felt really dumb. So I'm probably going to be giving my repeats to a friend of mine, because that's what I like to do when I have excess or double of something, is I like to rehome it. And I usually don't even bother trying to sell it because it takes more effort sometimes with like one or two than it would. Oh, so there's a third layer. I'm even able to get. And the markers on this paper are a little bit grainy, which is kind of interesting. Oh, and another thing, you can cap the markers to each other in case that is important to you. And maybe it is. I mean, I usually, if I'm working at a table, I'll try to put the markers next to me, but you might not be working at a table. Anyway, I think that's the first layer of skin. So far I'm pretty pleased. Can't wait to try these on other papers. And, but I always get really excited when my field test looks good. Oh, Splash is a really dark blue for the whites of her eyes. Dare I try using the Tombow ABT? Dare I? Oh, dang good thing I decided to scrub it, because there was some red in there still. And these kind of colorless blenders, their tips will get stained with use, but, you know, it's not the end of the world. Okay, let's just, even, I don't know. I mean, it is a very blue, but it's not bad. That's kind of cute. And the Tombow will move it on this paper. So we just gotta find an ink that works on this paper so we can get going. because, like, this paper and these markers like each other. You know, we gotta facilitate this relationship. So I'm gonna use baby pink on her lips and her cheeks, but it's such a pale pink. I really don't want to just, like, dive into pure red. I want to just call it poppy red because it really seems like a poppy red to me. And they will blend each other, so... but that's like a water-based marker kind of thing anyway, is if you apply a marker on top of another, like this, right? Okay, so we're applying this baby pink on top of many layers of fawn. It will just kind of like push it around and blend a little bit, but you're not going to get the sort of lines you would get with Copics. Which, it really depends on what you're looking for. If you want that sort of an alcohol-based marker look, then, you know, go with alcohol-based markers. If you are okay with, if you never use alcohol-based markers, or you're okay with kind of messing around and learning, these kind of things can be great because you don't necessarily have all of these preconceived notions of what an alcohol marker or what an art. Ah, okay. That worked. Ha. Very, very limited use of this pure red. You don't have your preconceived notions of what an alcohol marker should or should not be telling you you're doing it wrong or telling you the marker's not performing correctly. So, you know, TLDR, just don't expect these to function like an alcohol-based marker, really. Expect them to be their own thing that is blendable, and you can layer, but it's not exactly the same. It feels like the paper is a little sticky, which was a problem anyway with the alcohol-based markers and with the pigment markers. So this is not a problem that's unique to the brushables. It's a problem that is pervasive across the three marker types I have so far tested on this. I don't even know. I haven't done any watercolor markers on these yet. So for all I know, those could be like amazing. And I'm being really, really careful because smearing was such an issue. And the last place you want smearing to happen is on skin. Especially on the face. Because that just kind of forever affects the look. So. Might as well color the inside of Kara's eyes. And I think I kind of want her dress to be the darker color of, oh, you can't even see that. The darker blue of Splash. Wow, you probably couldn't see me doing bunny ears either. Air quotes. I'm so cool. I just think for water-based markers, these are really well designed because they make blending for water-based markers very easy. And Kuretake does do alcohol-based markers. It's their Kurecolor markers, and I've done a review on those on the blog before. When I tested them, they did not have a brush tip option. I don't know if they do now, at least offhand. If they did, I would definitely consider revisiting it, but as it stands, I prefer their water-based markers, and I really love their brush pens, like their inking brush pens. I use a Fude pen to ink all the time. I prefer those to their alcohol-based options. These seem very, especially the brushables, maybe I'm biased, The brushables seem very well planned for water-based markers. You've got your more saturated color, and then you've got your lighter color, so you can blend out a bit the way I'm doing, which is nice. Like, it makes, for people who have trouble selecting coordinating colors, this might make it a little easier for you. For me, I have problems with that too, so I have to like swatch everything out ahead of time. And they're pretty affordable. I think on Amazon, which tends to be kind of overpriced for art supplies, you can get a pack of, let's see, a pack of four, depending on the color, for $13.20 from the Kuratake Zig's Amazon storefront. So, which, I mean, that would be the place you'd want to get them from if you're getting them on Amazon anyway, for the most part, because that's buying them from the manufacturer. So, you know, if something goes wrong, you can take it up with the source. Not that anything should go wrong, but you know. $13.20 for four markers, which are technically eight markers because you're getting two colors, to me seems like a really, still a really good deal, even if they are water-based markers. Water-based markers tend to be a little cheaper than alcohol-based markers, but for, you know, crafting grade, adult grade markers, that's a really good price. Because they're in the memory system, it means they coordinate with clean colors, and they coordinate with the art and graphic twin colors. So really, like, I'm sorry, the more I'm thinking about this, the more I'm like, this is such a cool thing. They did such a good job. Has not paid to say any of this, by the way. I like Kuratake a lot as a company because I like their products, but they've never sent me anything at all. They just have my loyalty because I, Fudego Koji is my favorite inking pen and has been for like four, well, that and the Sailor Mitsuo Aida have been my favorite inking pens for like 4 or 5 years. I think they just make really neat stuff. Wish we got more of it easily in America. That's always the problem with loving Japanese art supplies, is there might be one or two vendors who carry the stuff you like, and you're kind of at their mercy for price and for shipping times and for what you're paying to have things shipped to you. The brushes on these handle, you know, I thought at first I was gonna really dislike them, but they actually handle really well. So, kudos there. I was just expecting them to be as soft and as squeaky as the Art and Graphic Twin. And they're not. They're a little harder, but that's okay, you know, because they're better able... You've only got one size of brush on these. You've got two brushes, but they're both the same size. So it's actually really smart on their end that it is a slightly stiffer brush, because you can do really fine details like hair... and it doesn't look mushy. It holds up, so. I like them. A+ so far. I'm sure something will happen to change my opinion at some point. And I'm adding slightly darker freckles to her skin. I'd already added a few with the darker, the darker end the shade of, or I'm sorry, the hue of fawn, not the tint of fawn. Gosh, what are the names of these? This one, root beer float, is 065. I was feeling kind of down today because my pigment marker test didn't really go very well, in my opinion. But this is going so much better, and I'm happy because I don't mind failing in front of you guys. I just don't want to always fail in front of you guys. I do a lot of, I do anime cons as like a way of making extra money, or making money, period. Let's be honest, let's be real here. Something I pride myself is I do at show commissions, and I used to do at show watercolor commissions. The reason I quit is because I would give customers an ETA, and you know, there's a lot of elements about watercolor you can't control, including the humidity of the world outside you. So you can give them an ETA, but it's really just an ETA. And I had an absurd number of customers every show come back like 10 minutes later to ask if their commission was done, or to like hound me into putting them higher in line. Regardless, I mean, they'd agreed to the ETA when I'd given it to them, but that wasn't, you know, wasn't good enough. And so I just quit offering at con watercolor commissions, which is a shame because I liked that I could do watercolors at a show. I liked that I had developed a process that worked for me, that let me give my customers what they wanted and charge a price that wasn't too obscenely low without being so out of their budget that they can't ever have original art, because I wanted to train them into valuing originals. You know, but I still do take home. I do mail-in watercolor commissions. And I have friends who do at-con Copic commissions, and I just... The watercolor thing was kind of my thing, and since that didn't really pan out in regards to customers understanding my boundaries, I don't want to offer Copics. Where I was going with that is I like the having the ability to perform to a certain extent on command. I am proud of my ability to produce a fairly consistent product regardless of my circumstance. And it has been, I don't want to say disheartening, but it's annoying, it's frustrating when my YouTube videos, the art in them, you know, I mean, I'm testing things or I'm trying new techniques or something and it just doesn't go the way it should go. And then when I'm doing it with the camera not on, it's so much better. But I mean, that can also be practicing with the material. Like, I have a Strathmore visual journal. I have several, actually. I bought several to test over the upcoming months. And I want the reviews to be a Patreon unlockable. Do I have two mixed medias or one mixed media? No, I have a watercolor, I have a Bristol, and I have a mixed media. And the watercolor, you know, I've never been a huge fan of Strathmore watercolor paper. There's just something about it and me, we just don't quite get along. And I've been really trying to use the visual journal, like, to do studies in it, because I think design-wise, it's a great journal. It's got two heavy chipboard covers, which means it's very sturdy. It's spiral bound, so I'm not constantly trying to hold the cover back or like tape the cover or clip the cover, which is things I've had to do with the moleskin and the other watercolor sketch journals I've had for when I go on trips. But the paper inside is just, you know, it takes a lot of getting used to, is what I'm gonna say. It's not my favorite paper. And I tried to record a video of me painting some thistles, and it looked horrible because I was trying to do arches paper technique, stuff that I know I can do on arches. I was trying to do it on Strathmore, you know. It doesn't even say the quality. It's the quality, I'm sorry. It's 140-pound cold-press wood pulp paper, you know. I mean, it is what it is, but it's not arches. And I was getting frustrated at myself because it seemed like every video I record with it looks horrible, but when I take time and, like, spend an evening doing several sketches, at least two of them look really good. And I mean, come on, that's like sketchbook logic 101, is like the majority of your sketches are going to look, you know, rough, especially while you're learning how to use a new material. It's probably not going to turn out perfect. So don't beat yourself up over it. Maybe don't record yourself using it. But I also wanted to, like, give you guys, like, how do I say this without... I want you guys to know that it's okay to fail. And it's even okay to fail publicly. You gotta, when you fail, you gotta own your mistakes and own your failures and try to learn from them. But more people should make mistakes publicly because that way more people can learn from it. And I sincerely feel that way, so I'm going to continue to fail on camera for you guys. But it's nice to succeed every now and then. Okay, so I'm using Splash, right? Yeah. I think I wrote Sprash because my brain was thinking spray and splash. And I'm using the tint of it. I had applied the tint all over for her dress, and now I'm kind of like knocking in some darker areas with the tint. And this color layers really well. There's already a significant difference between my first application and my second application. Anyway, you have permission to fail. I know on the internet it seems like all anybody does is the best work all the time. Everything they do is beautiful and polished and fantastic. I'm sorry. And that's because so many of us treat our online existence like it's a portfolio. And I guess to an extent it is. But, you know, there are portfolio sites where you can just post your beautiful finished work. And I try to share my general work to my blog and on my Twitter and on here now, and save the very polished, photoshopped until it's perfect. I'm not really a big fan of that personally, but you know, you do what you gotta do to get the product finished. I save that kind of work for my portfolio. And the kind of up and down thing about comics is not every page has to be a masterpiece. But boy, it sure feels like people latch on to the, especially with webcomics, people sure latch on to the one page that isn't up to snuff, in their opinion. Okay, so that's two layers of the tint of Splash, and I'm going to go over it when it's dried with the actual color of Splash. You know, I would have thought Splash as a color name would be like a very, very light blue. This is like a sky, you know? Like this blue is like the high part of the sky, and this part is the part where it's coming closer to the ground. And I wish... I'm glad I did, but I'm going to do some sky in there. It'll look cute. Probably still can if I erase where I wrote brushables. That was just a note to myself about what this piece is going to be used for. And I'll do that after I remove it from the tape. And it's a little bit tacky, and the water makes the paper bubble up a little bit. But it's not... For water-based markers, these are really not overly watery, if that makes sense. Some water-based markers just, like, saturate your paper to the point where you can't do anything anymore on it. I think I have used every color except for this platinum. Every color I bought. Oh, wow. Okay. So, like, the darker color of Splash is much, much bluer than my swatch on watercolor paper. And it's much bluer than the tint. But that's okay, because you can blend out a bit with these, and it looks cool. Oh, you know what I never did? I usually do a lavender shade, like shadows on skin tone, so I need to do that and either fail or succeed. I mean, I pretty much always do it with alcohol markers. Whether I do it with water-based markers, up in the air at this point, because it's like I've had so many bad results with it. And I think it's because with the water alcohol-based markers, if you use a light, I goofed a little bit. Let me see if I can clean that up. Yes. alcohol-based markers, when you put a lighter color on top, it will push the darker color to the back of the paper. Water-based markers don't perform like that at all. So that is important to keep in mind. And that's not a flaw of water-based markers. It's not a flaw of these markers. It's just the materials are very different. I think these markers perform in a very interesting way on this paper. I haven't yet used them on any other papers, so I don't know whether or not I like this a lot, or if this is just like how they always perform. I don't think it's how they always perform, though, because I can see the paper texture very much through them. They're very translucent. They don't evenly dye the paper underneath. And that's probably the Winsor and Newton, whatever they used on the paper to make it better for the pigment markers. Alright, so here's where I'm gonna ruin this. I think I'm gonna untape it to do the grass because I want to be able to rotate it. And then I can do the sky. Or do you think, should I do the sky? I really only want to do like a line of sky. I really want to take the coward approach. I mean, even this looks pretty cute, but I think if I can get it to full color, it's going to look really cute. Paper is so thin that it really wants to move around on you, and I really don't want it to. So I need, it's my responsibility to find a lighter blue and some greens and maybe a couple different browns. Buy a whole bunch more of these is the TLDR. I need to find a lighter. Do you guys see that? That's where my finger went. So I can't do any sort of touching of this except with a marker until it's dry. I'm gonna end up making a huge mess. Unfortunately, by doing all this sky stuff, I'm kind of making the lavender less, stand out less. There's less contrast. So I'm going to have to do something with the lavender. Either add
white. Oh, wow, look. It's, like, very dark blue compared to over here. Alright, that looks kind of half-baked. Like, really half-baked Becca Hilburn. The seventh grader is what that's looking like. Because it's not even a straight line. Well, you know, sometimes the more time you spend in something, the worse it looks, and sometimes the more time you spend doing something, the better it looks. So we're gonna try the more time you spend on something, the better it looks approach, and try and fill the sky in a bit more. Let's see if that doesn't help. Ugh. Sorry, my hand's cramping pretty bad. I have been comicking and recording and markering and drawing all day. So, pretty good day. But a painful day for the old hand. Okay, let's continue this fool's, all right, I get it, I remember now. So, with this, it's the Tombow ABT, by the way, it's not going to, these don't work the same way Copics do, or other alcohol-based blenders. In that it's going to pick up your color and kind of redistribute it, as opposed to Copic, where the alcohol-based blender just pushes stuff to the back. So this does actually blend to an extent, whereas Copic blender just kind of mutes colors for you. Yep, now, same problems. Too many layers. The Winsor Newton marker paper does not like layers, because it will start to scrape up. I was thinking that was a pigment marker problem. I'm seeing that's any old marker problem. Wow. That shouldn't be surprising, because it's a very thin marker paper. And thin marker papers tend to not really be for 10 billion layers the way I like to color. They tend to be for, like, in and out very quick. You put your color down and then you're done, kind of layering, which... Okay, so... This is what we've got so far. This guy is not great, but not horrible. Oh, it really wants to shift on me. It's so thin. Clean your blender marker when you're not using it.
because you don't want a dirty blender marker. All right, we're in the home stretch, kind of. I mean, I could continue to postpone the inevitable by doing my shading on the skin, like I said I was going to do.
You know, like under the chin with a little bit of lavender. Looks good so far. Over here. Under the arm. And right under the hair.
I swear, if my head's not in that video, I'm so surprised.
And right there.
But really, that's like, that's all of that I can do. So, it's telling me I have no more room. All right, gonna switch cameras and see if. So last night, my card ran out of space and I had to clear it, which took quite a few hours because there was several gigs of video on there. So it's morning now and I'm going to finish up this the Zig Brushables test. And like I'd mentioned earlier in the video, I didn't buy any greens, so I'm going to use two other markers from the Zig memory system, both of which are Zig art and graphic twins. And I reviewed this brand of markers. I've reviewed these on my blog, which is natosoup.blogspot.com. Just check the card and that should help you out. The brushes on the art and graphic twin are much larger, and the ink in the art and graphic twin just wants to like sit on top of the paper. It doesn't want to soak in. I think these are more watercolor markers than they are water-based art markers. And I am sorry, I haven't had my coffee yet. I just wanted to get this handled. The paper I'm using is Winsor Newton pigment paper, and I've explained earlier in the video why I had chosen the pigment paper. So, if you are using art and graphic twins on this paper for whatever reason, please keep in mind that it takes a really, really long time for it to dry. It's just sitting on top of the paper right now. And that's because this kind of paper has a coating. So if you want to do layers or, pretty much just layers, you're going to have to keep the dry time in mind, because that's just not going to work. I mean, you can't put another layer of marker on it while it's wet like this, because it's just going to pick up all of the color and look kind of like a mess. It might look like a mess anyway. These might end up ruining this piece. I hope not, because I kind of liked it for what it was. And a cat hair got in it, and it wants to drag the ink all over the place. And you can't see it, and my phone is all the way across the room, so I can't take a good picture. But you see where it's pooling, and it's making the paper kind of buckle? So while the brushables worked okay on this paper, the art and graphic twin does not, and that probably means the clean color brush markers won't either. Real brush markers, I should say. I've always had problems rendering grass where there's like lots of stuff to interrupt the brush stroke. It just takes so much longer. And there's a good risk that'll end up looking like mud. So I'm trying to be careful I also don't want to pull into other areas where I've put down ink. Since these are so wet, it's very likely to reactivate. Okay, so I'm going to have to let this dry before I can really move on. Okay, so it seems like that first layer is dry, so I can keep moving. I just wanted it to be dry so if I needed to rest my hand on it, it wouldn't smear everywhere. And although this isn't like a how to use these kind of markers tutorial, for grass and for hair, with this kind of a brush, you really want to take advantage of like long flicking strokes, because it makes it looks much more realistic, and it's actually very easy to do. That's why soft brush nims are so great, and why so many artists want them. I was really having a lot of trouble the other night doing the pigment marker field test, because it's so hard to maneuver that chisel nib and that bullet nib for me, especially because the bullet nib, I was doing some drawing, I was doodling with those markers last night off camera, and something I noticed that was really bothering me is like my sap green, for example, because I was doodling kitchen herbs, the sap green from the bullet nib doesn't even come out. Like, there's no pigment. The color from the chisel nib is so much darker. So, I mean, I was having trouble just doing, like, a very basic three-layer illustration because I couldn't get the pigment to come out of the bullet nib. So I was having to use the chisel nib to do the drawing for me, you know, and you can't get fine lines with that. So I guess I need to make a note of that for my final Prismacolor pigment review. Pigment marker review. I'm so sorry. Winsor and Newton pigment marker review. So, that's also saturated, so I have to let that dry for a while. Again, though, it is not the fault of these markers, and it is not the fault of this paper. They're not designed to be used together. If I put down a line on this uncoated cardstock, it dries almost, it soaks into the paper almost immediately. And it takes a while for water-based markers to dry anyway. So just keep that in mind when you're using this kind of a coated marker paper, that it's not going to absorb your ink. Your inks are going to sit on top. There's going to be long dry times. So those of you who are watching this, not only for the review, but to see how I handle this illustration. So I left some of the stems, that cross over Kara, I left that kind of white. And that was because you don't, with this kind of a thing, you don't want all of the grass to cover her, but you want some of the grass to, because it gives an illusion of depth. If you have all of the grass cover her, it's going to look really muddy. And it's going to be hard to read. And you may have also noticed that I had faded out on her legs, and that's because I wanted it to look like she was standing in this lavender. So I intentionally left the legs less rendered so I could fill that in, and it wouldn't look muddy or too busy. And since the ink pools on the page, I am trying to be careful, especially with when I work, just to prevent it from getting too saturated, too hard to work with, really. And like I'd said before, this really isn't the paper that these markers are designed for. And in my review of them, I treated them as watercolor markers, and now I really want to go back and review them again as just marker markers, because I think I'm really liking these too. So I guess I'm going to be generating more work for myself with more reviews. Anyway, I need to let this dry. I think you guys have probably got the gist of working and letting it dry and working and letting it dry. And as you can see, it's kind of causing the paper to curl a little bit from the moisture. That's just something to keep in mind. Hopefully together we can find paper that allows these wonderful water-based markers to shine, because I think they're underappreciated in the art community. They're affordable. Hopefully they'll become more accessible. And it's the sort of thing where I know artists who are uncomfortable bringing their Copic markers to cons because they're heavy. There's a lot of them. Secondly, they're really genuinely afraid that somebody's going to steal their markers, which happens every now and then. It really doesn't happen that often, but it's still a concern when you have a $600 marker collection. So with water-based markers, it would be a shame if your water-based marker collection walked, but it wouldn't be the end of the world. Especially because Zig and Tombow have large sets for under $100, which is very reasonable when compared to their alcohol-based equivalents. So I'm going to let this dry, and I'll get back to you guys. All right, so it looks like the layer I just applied finally dried. So I can slowly make progress. And another thing about coloring grass is you don't want to fill in all of the space. You want to leave some white. It looks more natural as grass that way. Especially up here where the grass would be kind of thinning out, mostly just the tall grass. And I mean, the limitations of these markers on this paper is making it kind of hard for me to do that, in addition to like all of the other elements in this piece. But in general, I would be much more careful about having the surrounding grass at different heights and trying to make smoother brush strokes and trying not to fill in the whole area like it's a coloring book. And I think we might actually get this layer done in one take, which would be nice. Oh my goodness. Shut up, Skype. All right, so I need to let that dry, and then I can start adding I can add grass blades with this color. Sorry. So the goal with this second color isn't even to fill in nearly as much green as this. It's just to add some variety to it so it doesn't look too mushy. To kind of draw in some individual grass blades. Unfortunately, the paper is curling enough that it really makes it difficult to control with a busted finger. And I don't want to put my fingers on the paper too much because I don't want to smear it. Which makes it a challenge, not necessarily a fun challenge. Sorry, my hand is blocking this. I'm really doing my best to try and hold the paper without putting my fingers down on the ink, just in case the ink does want to smear. But I think that's about it. I think that's about done. And I think it turned out pretty well. I feel like it turned out better than the pigment marker test I did, which looked kind of sloppy. So that was like field test one for Zig brushable markers, and it ended up being inadvertently also messing around with Zig Art and Graphic Twin on Winsor Newton pigment marker paper. I hope you guys have found this helpful. Please stay tuned for even more field test videos from me. Have a good day, guys. Oh, wait. Before I sign off, if you like this video, if you found this video helpful, please consider sharing it with your friends, hitting like, hitting subscribe, and leaving a comment telling me what you thought. Your encouragement makes these videos possible. If you have ideas for future videos, also, please leave me a comment. I would love to hear them. I'm always looking for new ideas. So, have a good day, guys. Goodbye.